I'm getting in the time between sessions, I'm spending time following up all this great music, actually. I've been listening to a lot of Marvin Gaye today. It's fantastic, especially live. So yeah, I'm gonna come out of this retreat with a lot of new Spotify playlists. So yeah, wherever this music's coming from, I'm really appreciating it. But yeah, welcome everybody. Maybe we could just spend a little bit of time, if you wish, here, just kind of visually welcoming and saying hello to each other. That's it. Yeah, it's getting some fingers and hands in the rectangles. Great. Yeah, it's such a kind. There's so much sort of mutuality. I love this term. Co-creation, how each of us is showing up on this retreat is conditioning all the rest of us, and there's all this kind of chemistry of interaction kind of going on. So just to say, I know some of you can't make the session one each of the days, and just a reminder that the sessions are recorded. So if you can't make the session one, you may not know what's happening in session one. You might want to catch up with it later. So but pretty much all through the week, Singer Shri and me have been exploring the three core practices in Tri Ratna: the mindfulness of breathing, the metta bhavana, and just sitting, and particularly around working with emotions. So yeah, do feel free to check those out. There's normally a led sit, and there's been some time for inquiry. My voice is slightly going, so if there's nothing wrong with the sound, probably it's just my voice is going a bit. So this session, we're going to hear more from Viveka, more precious time to hear from Viveka. And she's going to be sharing around the appreciation of Tonglen practice as a way of being with emotion. And then we'll have a break, and then we'll have small groups or home groups. So just on that, if for whatever reason you would rather not be in a group, if you could let Dai K2 know in the next few minutes or so, just to give him plenty of time to kind of cook up the groups, for after break. So yeah, if you don't want to be in a group, if you could let Dai K2 know, that would be great. And then we'll just come back for a short practice. So let's do a little bit of arriving practice. So here again, we're going to just explore how this impacts the felt sense of the body, sense of ease, safety, energy levels. So I just invite you to place your right hand just underneath your left armpit, and then your left hand on the outside of your right arm. Can you see that here? Is the camera low enough? Yeah. And then just, well, in a way, there's nothing you need to do here because the system will be sensing it. So I don't know how this exercise is landing with you this afternoon, but part of the idea is that it gives the body a sense of containment. It's feeling its edges here. Okay, and then from there, just coming out of that. And the second thing I'd like to introduce here is what's sometimes called visual resourcing. So again, this is something that can register with our early part of the brain that is very sensitive and constantly scanning the level of safety. So what I'd invite you to do here is there something, is there a picture, is there an object, is there something you can look at in the room you're in that for you has some kind of associations with being well or a happy memory or safety, something that you like to look at, you know, whatever that is for you. And then this is a really, really simple practice. It's just getting a comfortable posture in relationship to that. And then we're just going to have like a minute or two. And the invitation here is for you just to allow yourself to look at it and just again to notice somatically how that is. For you, just to allow yourself to experience it. So we'll just have a minute or two with this. Yeah, gradually coming out of that. So that's a very simple resourcing technique. And sometimes I've used that in meditation. You know, if there's something that I'm on that is on the edge of overwhelm or that, you know, I feel like it would be helpful to relax, I can just sit with my eyes open as that as the object, you know. Again, on some level, that's likely to be registered, the associations. Yeah. So I'll pass over to Viveka.
Right. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. So we're going to do a little Tonglen practice today, and I want to say a little bit of appreciation about the practice, and then we'll spend some time with it. So Tonglen is practiced as an expression of what we were exploring yesterday in the session, that longing, bodhicitta, the heart of awakening to trembling with the world, compassion, trembling with, so the awakening heart, bodhicitta. And we talked yesterday about the dharmas, really, you know, in taking on the central question of human suffering, dukkha. Not just seeing that as an individual problem, but actually seeing how that that each of us in the community of beings, you know, can touch on that in that suffering intimately here, but also in connection with all of life. You know, so it's not a solo activity. And also, apropos of the exercise Balajit just led, you know, Buddhism also offers us like a knowing that there's an alternative, you know, and we call that faith, yeah. And when it's really known, it's like an integrated, embodied wisdom, yeah. And yeah, when we feel like there's something about how our body trembles with suffering, but we also, there's all sorts of resonances we can have in the body. So we've talked about energy. I think resonance is really interesting. Singing is resonant. You know, there's something in us, and Sangha actually used this image, that there's something in us that responds to the possibility of freedom, or yeah, freedom from suffering, or other ways you would put that, you know, how you would relate to that. Yeah, something that can be felt, just like that exercise we just did, you know, we were like, oh, let's find something that actually feels soothing in our room, something that has meaning maybe. And it just takes that principle that we have a capacity to open to beauty in this particular sort of way. Yeah. So as we tremble with the suffering of the world, we also have the capacity to resonate with, to sync up with the possibility for freedom. Yeah, the freedom song, Monica McIntyre, fantastic. Not a Buddhist, so I think it's just a human capacity, you know. I mean, it's amazing because she's singing a freedom song. She's singing out loud. I want someone to sing me a freedom song all day and all night long. Freedom, freedom, freedom. Yeah. Yeah, so it's like this call and response in our universe, this resonance. So yeah, it's important to pay attention to that as well. You know, it's said we have a negativity bias for our survival is to look out for danger. And we talked about that being, you know, being a fully functioning human being. However, if it gets too, if we're living too much just in that, and it's too dominant, you know, that really, it really, we're missing a whole part of our capacity, and we'll feel it. And, you know, I think our world will feel it. We can collectively create the San Francisco currently. And this is not funny, but it's only funny just because it's just, people, you know, it's really, it's like our response to the suffering in San Francisco is our media has decided to pick up this thing has really caught on. And everywhere you hear about it, there being a doom loop. So if we look at the most common phrase associated with San Francisco right now, it will be doom loop. I mean, doom loop sounds bad, you know? It's so bad that my mother, who's in San Diego, Southern California, is sending me articles from the New York Times that is reporting on San Francisco's doom loop. To say, have you seen this? And so we create a doom loop, a narrative of doom. Yeah. And a lot of the doom loop centers around San Francisco's downtown, which I happened to visit yesterday, because a lot of For some reason, a lot of dentists' offices are downtown. It's just a thing in San Francisco. And it was really interesting because I was really wanting to experience what was happening, you know, and not just have the thought, don't just be walking through the thought of doom loop, but actually to experience with my senses this place, these people, what was happening. Yeah. So anyway, I feel like we can get into doom loops. It's a fantastic phrase. Doom loops. And you know, I know that I've been working with a lot of what I do is I work with a lot of activists who are trying to really collaborate, you know, as forces for a transformed world in which there's safety, dignity, and belonging, yeah, sustainability. We're living in harmony with our planet and respect with of each other. And it's really interesting because they've been gathering, you know, there's a lot of, these are tough times. They've been gathering to see what can we do. And I was really struck by what has emerged from recent meetings together, where we're really in a retreat-like environment. So really trying to move from a threat kind of way of being to a more creative way of being. Yeah, there's a lot of space in the agenda. There's a lot of loving activities structured into the agenda. Yeah. And what's emerged is that we need a vision of what the world we're trying to create. You know, we can't just be in a tomb loop and try to survive it. We actually need to exercise our capacity to dream more. You know, that wishing, that longing. And so I really was moved by that. You know, that was their prescription for themselves and their communities. And it was interesting because we tried a round of it as a practice together, and it wasn't super technical. You'd think you get this bunch of people that understand like policy, like nobody's business. You know, they understand how, I don't know what unemployment insurance works, you know, healthcare works. But the narratives were really probably ones that people here can relate to, you know, like children being safe to play and multi-generational families, you know, in healing, able to really feel that they're in community together. Yeah. That our food, that we have connection to our sources of food. And if we're actually deeply nourished by our food. Our food is nourishing. We are nourished. I mean, it was just really touching to be in that. And it was funny because they were saying, wow, I wonder if, you know, people that typically fund the kind of work they do heard this, how they would respond, you know, would they be like, you all are wasting your time, or would they, you know, like you need to be productive about our doom loops, you know, and I really felt like they had faith that they needed that positive dream, you know. And it reminds me of something else I was once very deeply moved by. It was a show called Philosophy Talk here, and they went around interviewing different spiritual leaders about this idea that what if nothing exists, like the way we think it does? And depending on various traditions, they were really like, whoa, okay. But you got to the Zen Buddhist and no problem. The Zen Buddhist was like, oh yeah, things that nothing exists the way we think it does, no problem. What if nothing really exists in, you know, any kind of permanent, substantial way, no problem. But what an answer. So Norman Fisher imposed with this, you know, you could say the greatest potential existential anxiety of instability, says, of course it's all unreal in the way, you know, in the way that we try to grasp onto it. Of course. So of course it's all a dream, but why not make it a beautiful dream? Why not make it a beautiful dream? Oh. It's really, people who know me might have heard me say this a million times because I'm so moved by that. So anyway, so maybe the title of this session is From Doom Loops to Beautiful Dreams. Yeah. So Tonglen really, it's the both and of that. Yeah, that there's suffering and then like really making space for a beautiful dream to actually be enacted, to be embodied here. Yeah. And it can include all our, we don't have to know exactly how we're going to get from A to B. from, we don't have to know every policy step along the way, but we're opening a channel. And we're opening a channel in this very body. And a principle here is, I want to bring into the retreat, and our embodiment is this wish, may this body stand with or be with or breathe with all bodies. So the team were talking a bit before about how a critique of working in an embodied way is sometimes, which the team wasn't particularly supportive of this critique, but we were hearing it, that it could be seen as very narcissistic, you know, that, oh, I'm gonna really learn how to be in this body. And I wanna say that it's a very old tradition. In fact, if we actually know what Milarepa was doing up in the mountains all those years, part of what Milarepa was doing was working very deeply in Tibetan yogas, working with the channels, the chakras, opening up the channel in his body, in their body. I think I kind of feel like Milarepa was beyond gender binaries in their body, Milarepa's body. Yeah, you know, the integrating like solar and lunar energies and learning how to be with the whole diversity of experience and very deeply doing that on behalf of all beings. Yeah, so even, you know, we may do it in different ways. This having this body actually literally connected. Someone said yesterday, how do I come into this open dimension of being? I'm aware of the pores on my skin. Fantastic. All the pores in our skin. So Balajit's like, oh yeah, our skin gives us this shape of this body here, the edges of our skin, right? We just did that at the start. And all the skin is covered in pores. So there's this porousness. Yeah, both end. So with Tonglen practice, you know, the setup, the flashing into the open dimension of being, we just, as we start the practice, it takes place within an enlightened perspective. You know, I said, what if we started our practice resonating yesterday with the enlightened perspective here now? Yeah, the awakening heart here now. So from the start, we resonate with this, it's our potentiality. And also how it is right now. It's not just something that it's that we hopefully one day, if we cross our fingers, we'll have more of a sense of. It's truly here right now. That who we are deeply, when we really come deeply, deeply home. It's very hard to describe in words, but what we'll find is this openness. Yeah. A vividness or clarity, an awakeness, yeah, clarity and sensitivity. And we're learning how to inhabit that, come home to that, yeah, with compassion that, yeah, with compassion that there's, that we're conditioned. So there's been ways in which we've been shaped away from that and to work kindly. You know, I heard this morning you were working about how to be a kind parent to yourselves at an adult age. Yeah. Kindly sing yourself a freedom song. Yeah. I like to actually kind of, yeah, soften our way back home. Yeah. So in Tonglen, we have this perspective of this openness and that we're not doing alone. I think perhaps in depending on how we've been cultured by our conditioned and shaped by our societies, maybe we start by feeling we're alone. But if we open to this wisdom perspective, we are not doing it alone. We're joining a multi-generational long arc of wishing. Yeah. Yeah. So that's the perspective when we start. And then we just come to the body and the breath. And we just notice as we breathe in, sort of open to just that it's hard to be with certain experience. I actually think it's maybe it's rather than imagining we're forcing ourselves to be with what's difficult, we breathe and we sort of notice that it can be hard to be with certain experiences. And we traditionally said we breathe that into the most tender spot of the heart. You know, it's like we meet our sensitivity. Our sensitivity is actually appreciated, respected, and honored in a way. We just feel that tenderness. Sometimes it's a bit much to go just with the heart. So I feel like it can be helpful just generally in the field of the body, just more as the breath comes in, just receiving that. Oh yeah, being human is to be tender. Yeah. So we just do that right now, just as we breathe in, just on that in breath, just letting that be okay, that it can be tender and we're not broken. As we breathe out, just allow some space for that, like some soothing around that. Yes. So in the traditionally we're giving an image of the out breath being like cool white moonlight, a soothing image. Yeah. As we breathe in right now, it's okay to be tender. In fact, that's sensitivity, our trembling. It's just part of what we come home to, part of an important aspect of who we are. So in this part of the practice, there's this space to notice, space for vulnerability. Yeah. And space for being vulnerable about how being vulnerable is, you know, infinite tremblings around that. We can even feel our armoring, you know, feeling our armoring as we breathe in is an access point to our vulnerability. So we might feel, oh, if I feel armored, I can't feel my vulnerability. Well, our armoring actually is the place of vulnerability. Just notice the quality of out breath that helps you be with that in breath of opening to our vulnerability. Like I notice I take nice long out breath. My body knows it needs a nice long out breath after opening to that. And there's a little bit of a sigh there. Oof. What do you notice? What is your body now? When we open to tenderness, to suffering, how can that out-breath resource us? So we're not having to be like frantically active, yeah. Different way of being with. So as you notice, maybe you could chat, our bodies can help other bodies. How does that out breath want to help you be with life's tenderness? it's a bit, maybe you notice it's a bit hard to go from feeling to just try and capture it in words. Yeah, maybe it's beyond, defy the chat description. Ooh. Anyone we haven't heard from yet, like to just unmute and share? You don't have to come on Spotlight. You can just unmute and share for a moment. If anyone wants to unmute and just say what you notice and the quality of out-breath. Dropping down. Yeah, often when we leave experience, we pick up. Yeah, I love that. Just coming home, dropping down. Beautiful, Ellen. Thank you. Soft, slow, letting go. Wow. It's like, feels like a very helpful mantra. We might have to have retreat bumper stickers, stickers printed of that. That's good. I'll try that as we breathe in and then breathe out, soft, slow, letting go. Thank you for that gift. Angela. Angela. Feels grounding. Kavya Shriya, grounding, finding ground. A bit of heaviness coming in. Rosa says, acceptance and letting be. Tapani. A deeper connection with the diaphragm and solar plexus. Yeah. Yeah, it's fantastic. Yeah, we have this inner architecture that's metabolizing. Yeah, it's actually literally metabolizing. I mean, actually transformative, transforming oxygen and then also other energies. Yeah, beyond the biological functions. Like a wave on the sea going back out, Rebecca. Oh, fantastic. Joining with the vast tidal energies. Yeah, like that poem we had the other day. Look in the Padlet, the tides. Okay. I feel like we'll just do Tonglen like this together. We'll keep exploring together. Yeah, we're going to do a radically supported Tonglen together this morning. Okay. So breathing, but encouragement from each other about how that out breath can resource us. Yeah. So Tonglen, now with this breath, more watery images from Moira, watery, spacious, with tiny bubbles moving through. Just want to invite us to really have a sense of what it's like doing this together. So I want to gift us with this somatic memory of doing this together so that when you're on your cushion or in the world anytime, feeling that sensitivity, trembling with the world, that you have a sense of that your body is supported in doing this with other beings. Yeah. So in the context of the practice, the breath is happening in a larger context. So as we open to flash into bodhicitta, this larger dynamic field of caring for our world, unconditional love. And just riff off the meditation of this morning. So this morning, we were remembering how metta, the image of, can imagine the most caring kind of love. Yeah, like a mother's love in the healthiest sense. Yeah. Like imagine you have, maybe some of you have this, the capacity to actually all have the capacity to, for life to spring forth through us. Yeah. Actually, I think maybe as I'm speaking, this metaphor is kind of going deeper for me. Some of you have actually given birth, all of us in a way, deeper way, and then being this channel for experience. Yeah. You're also, the world is birthing itself through us, where we are the ultimate, fertile ground, bringing us to the image of the womb of Prajna Paramita, a much more alive image for Shunyata, a fertile space. And this is what we bring to mind as we do this practice, the wisdom perspective, the fertile womb of everything. Deeply loving, intimate with that. Just being here in that mystery together. Yeah, that's the setup. It's the cosmic setup as it is. And you belong. Yes. You are a beautiful arising, as are all of us. So as we learn to heal that relationship with ourself, we learn to heal our relationship with all. So let's just start with that aspect of the practice here, the deep belonging of everything that can be experienced, whether we call it me or you or we, or it's beyond words. So as we breathe here, deep belonging, breathe in the tenderness of that. Parts of us that don't believe it or perhaps find it hard to relax into that. Breathing in, we just breathe with the tenderness of that. And like how a mother might rock a baby on the out breath, it's okay. Those of you who have a connection with a particular Buddha or Bodhisattva, maybe they're here with you. Yeah, it's also very traditional. Inviting you to resonate with that compassionate wake, heart, mind, yeah. Come home here. Ah, I just had a yawn, good sign of releasing tension. Come home. Right here. Rovi offers us that there's belonging and be the longing. The longing and be the longing. You won't have to reveal any of this, but what are those parts we tend to banish that generally are like, oh, you can't be here? And what if those parts too in ourselves are welcome? For ourselves and for others, yeah. So if it's hard for you to do it, you can imagine the others on this screen here with us, the others on this retreat, creating a space of welcoming those parts too. You can say that to yourself, you're welcome. You can put it in the chat if you want to let us help you. Even the parts that banish, the banishers in me, welcome. A heart wide enough to reach the lands of banishment. Deep enough to go find, and you don't have to drag them away, but just say hello. Yes, the hungry ghosts that hide in the shadows, yes. I need to drag you into the light, but just know you belong. Breathing in a bit like a deep dive, yeah. Breathing out the soothing. Pulling. Holding all that suffering, that tenderness. It's helped by, supported by needs. Taboo, the banished. Reaching out to people in San Francisco's downtown that may be struggling with drug addiction. You're not just a doom loop. You're not a doom loop. Tender, hard to feel. Ooh. You belong in our world. Yeah. Breathe with the hungry ghost realms in us, in our world. It's hard to feel like there's nourishment. Yeah, maybe Breathe out, imagining together, extending nourishment, receiving nourishment for ourselves. Breathe out. Too much. We can just take a rest breaths. Yeah. Just here in that large, we come back to the view. Remember the view. Don't need to be madly pumping the bellows in this practice. Yeah. There's pacing. Come back to feeling the ground. Yeah. So when there's a sense of overwhelm, how do we come back to just enough containment? Yeah. So again, we don't need to be pushing the heart out. We can rest. Let's appreciate where our tenderness is supported, maybe knowing we're not doing this alone, maybe opening the eyes. But it can be so helpful to have an altar. It might be images on a shrine or an image in your room, coming back to that. We can just be with and fill up with. So there's some part of the practice that helps us with a sense of overwhelm, which could, there's two ways to work with a sense of overwhelm. So maybe now we can just open our eyes and just notice how we're doing between the middle way, between suppression and overwhelm, or, yeah. Where are we? Where's that middle way? Just feeling for that. How do you know? So this is part of what happens in practice, is to notice what's happening when we do emotional practices. Just even that noticing. And help stabilize. What can I do to resource myself? I need to connect more with the beauty of longing. Have a look at Teshvara. Is it okay to feel? Maybe it's okay to feel what I'm feeling. Just notice. Maybe we've been shaped, you know, that to be told that tears are wrong, and then actually, well, maybe I'm okay. Just checking in. Can I be with this? Yeah. Am I tipping over into overwhelm? And there's options besides swinging all the way to shutting down. Yeah. Like, how can I find the middle way here? And this is true in life, right? Like, we're actually tonglening through life, hopefully, in a way of being having an awake heart through life, because we are we're encountering different tendernesses. Yeah. How do we find the middle way? Anyone want to share what we're noticing? And say spotlight or off spotlight. Well, actually, I think, why don't we just stay in the gallery? Because I think stay in gallery view would find that person, because then we feel more like we're with each other. Yeah. You could raise your hand. Let us know if you're willing to say hi to us, or let us say hi to you and say hi. Yeah. And love on you a little. How you doing down at us? I'm seeing you, neighbor. Would you be okay with saying hi, or you wanted to stay quiet there? You're fully in choice. Okay.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm feeling a lot of a tremendous amount of gratitude, and I feel deeply held and cared for in this space. So it just feels like there's a lot of healing and nourishment coming in. And the way that that manifests in my body, it's just this. It's like, just kind of my body turning to jello.
Just lingering with that. You're being with, resonating with your jello-ness.
My jello-ness. There's a song in there.
Could you share a little more about gratitude that's happening right now?
Yeah, I've been immersed in a protracted conflict with two people who are very important relationships in my life, and something Balajit said a couple days ago really struck me, where Balajit said something about when one is ignored, the heart hardens, something to that effect. And I saw in my own experience this sense of my heart has hardened as a result of this protracted conflict. And then that coupled with something you said, Viveka, about how I feel numb, that numbness is a feeling, you know, like, I feel numb. Like, so there was this acceptance of feeling numbness, and then coupled with hardened, like, to me, like, that numbness is, it's an expression of hardness, like the heart hardening, like there's a wariness And I'm very aware that beneath that, there is a tremendous amount of tenderness and sadness and grief. And to feel in this practice, like the hardness, the numbness melting. And I just love that image of just turning into jello, of just melting, just shedding the armor, the need to protect. And there's, oh. And then to just come into the contact with, direct contact with them, the fruits of practice, the open dimension of being, just a sense of, yes, everything is perfectly imperfect. It's fine, just it's fine. And I just feel so grateful for that. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel grateful for that too. Yeah, I feel grateful for you. Yeah, I can feel you about 15 blocks away. My heart's like 15 blocks wider to you. Yeah, neighbor. Yeah. And you said in the beginning, feeling held. Yeah, so you're in this space where you feel held. Yeah. How does your body know you're held? Like gifting itself heldness.
So I love, you know, some of these somatic practices from Balajit, some of them are like, what? You know. But some of them just like have just landed with me. So I'm finding myself. I love the one where you put your hands on your thighs and you just do this. And it's as if I've got a new cat and it's sitting here on my lap. So, and then just this, like I can hold myself, which is kind of interesting, you know. So if I don't feel held, you know, just do things like this. And there's something so simple, so beautiful, and yet so profound all at the same time.
Yeah. That's sweet. Yeah. Yeah. Profound access to the feeling of being held. Yeah. Knowing being held. Yeah. For that. Yeah, and there's resonance. Yeah, Mandy's writing here, in this space, feeling held and calm. This theme of feeling held, yeah. Opening palms outwards, feeling the energy and sense of vastness between me and the rest of the world, visualizing the blue dot. Okay. Feeling held. So maybe, maybe one of our being, you know, like, it's like when you get power tools, you know, and they always say, use these responsibly. Use these power, do not use this chainsaw irresponsibly. It's something about, well, the power tools of really, you know, coming into bodhicitta, the awakening heart, yeah, into relationship with that. Maybe using, doing that responsibly involves tending to being held, just remembering we're being held and not doing the practice hastily or in a way where we're no longer in touch with being held. Yeah, being held by the lineage of all those who've gone before, being held by the earth. Yeah. Being held by our skin. Yeah. Yeah, in the way this the holding of the skin is such a beautiful reminder that we are, we can be hurt. Yeah, it's just a help, a wonderfully respectful holding. Yeah. Yeah, being held by that armoring in the sense of, reminder, I can be hurt. Yeah, so let me be. Let me be. It's not just like hurtling ourselves into danger with no thought for all that. Yeah. But also maybe being held by vastness. I love this. It's very intriguing paradox, right? Mandy saying, being held by the sense of vastness that can also hold us. I want to actually invite us to also notice that too. Yeah. It doesn't have to be you figuring it all out and now in the second. I also felt like that a little bit of release down at us. Like, I don't have to freaking figure this out. I mean, at some point, there may be a conversation where like something else needs to happen, but also like, yeah, gifting yourself and not just hardening. Yeah. So the vastness, like really moving out of the oppression of time, as it says in the something, Sutra of Golden Light. There is a time, there will be a time for various types of strategic or an NVC maybe. Needs and values based communication. Yeah. Can we be resourced by this deep dimension of well-being? All right. So just before we end, let's take a few minutes just to feel into that, what it's like to be resourced by the vastness. Suzuki Roshi has this wonderful teaching in Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind, which I feel like is a clue to this. It says, give your sheep a big pasture. So sometimes there's like, we just have to learn how to work with each other. There's not a one size fit all moment. Sometimes there's too much containment. Sometimes there's not enough containment. If there's too much containment, then we're starting to get closer to suppression, right? Like it's just like we're trying to manage it all. Yeah. So there's just, it's interesting with containment. So sometimes it's like we're just trying to hold it all too close. Like the breath is feeling a bit claustrophobic and we're just like, I'm trying to sort it out. And in a way, when we open up to more space in meditation, we are in touch with the larger, there's this body breathing here, but there's also this larger body of truth. We've called it the greater sphere of awakening energy, of awakening. That fertile womb. And the practice is less strange, but in a way it's less tightly localized right here. Yeah. Like we're here and it's not, the whole universe isn't having to channel itself through this one body. Yeah. Which is why I think it's helpful to imagine that many people are doing bodhicitta practice all the time around our globe at any moment and have throughout time done it. They will in the future. We're participating in something. Okay, so let's just try that and before we end and then we'll have a break. So you might let your body feel for the horizon. So beyond the screen, you might let the front body feel for the horizon. Imagining, maybe you can imagine the nearest ocean and feel for that. Yeah, even if it's very far away, imagine for the horizon of the nearest ocean. Feel for that. And let the back body also open to the curvature of the earth and feel for the vast oceans closest to the back of the body. You don't have to name them, just intuitively know them. Just opening up. Tides pulling, the earth turning in different relationships to the moon, causing the waves to come and go. The breath, like the tidal waves coming in and out. So there's this openness, heart mind like the vast ocean, like the sky. And this body here, all the feelings that ripple through, it's just as it is, deeply belonging like the waves belong to the ocean. Pores of the skin, breathing, your breathing, just being with. You get to be with, you don't have to solve it all. Know that you matter. It's noticing for a resonance in the body. There's said to be a resonance we can find, a central channel running from. As we breathe, running from the crown to the root. Imagine felt as deep blue, deep cosmic blue, night sky, deep ocean blue. Ah. On this channel is the energetic middle way. So as we breathe, there's a centering in this body. Breathing from earth to belly to heart to crown and back down again, centering. With sensation. The central channel can be quite located right inside the body, in front of the spine as an energetic channel, and can also be completely just a channel for everything, all that can be experienced. That whole ocean. The depths of the ocean, the farthest star. May this body breathe and resonate with all bodies. Healing song, freedom song. Power song, feeling our aliveness. Okay, so just having a wiggle and just coming back. We're about to move into break. I'm gonna hand over to someone who's going to help us make that transition. Thank you all.
Thanks, Viveka. I don't think I've ever heard you refer to the central channel as a resonance, or if you have, I haven't heard it. It didn't go in however many times you might have said it to me. But I love that. Yeah, really feeling that. Okay, welcome back from your groups. I hope that was enough time to be able to have some meaningful connection with folks. So yeah, so as always, we will have a harvesting session this in the last session of the day, in an hour and a half from now. So yes, Viveka, I believe, has set up in the Padlet. Maybe Diakita, you could drop the link again in the chat. Harvesting from Tonglen Practice with a beautiful image of the Rainbow Buddha there. And the prompts. So do feel free to add any comments. Yeah, just anything that came up for you that either you shared or anything that resonated for you from what someone else might have shared in your groups. And you can also drop them into the chat here between now and the end of the session, and we'll make sure that those get captured. So that's what we'll be doing this eve. I do have some reflections on time with this thing about like how conditioned we are to talk about when things are happening by the time of the day, because I have not been able to shake that habit on this retreat as much as I've tried. It's very interesting. It's very interesting that, but anyways, yes, in the late session. So we'll just end by finding our ground again. Maybe you haven't lost it, but I definitely have. just feeling that connection with your seat, maybe doing a little bit of looking around again. That transition from groups back to the main room on Zoom can be a little bit sudden and jumpy. So we're just letting the system settle. Maybe you even feel a little bit of sadness leaving your group behind. So just noticing if there's anything like that happening. And we'll just breathe together for a minute before we end. Just noticing how the breath is now. Deep bow of gratitude to all of you in your practice and to Viveka for leading us in that beautiful collective Tonglen earlier. And we will see you in an hour and a half. Feel free to make any reactions or unmute yourself to say goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, everyone.
Yes. Thank you so much. Bye, everyone.
Thank you all. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. Auf Wiedersehen.
Yeah, cheers.
Thank you.
Cheers.